Good morning. Grace and peace to you all in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome to worship here at First Presbyterian Church of Highlands. Welcome back if we have missed you. Welcome for the first time. We are so glad you are here. Welcome if we haven't seen you since last week. And speaking of last week, if it wasn't great, if it was the best week you've ever had, if it has left you feeling like you don't know what is to come this week, know that you have come to a place where your soul will be fed, where your heart can be filled, and that you will be given what you might need to step into next week. With that assurance, I invite you to rise in body or in spirit so that we might join together in our opening litany. We come to worship the one who feeds us. We come hungry for the bread of life. We come to praise the one who nourishes us. We come hungry for our daily bread. We come together as Christ's body, the church. We come hungry for the sustenance of the Holy Spirit. So let us worship the one who feeds us with eternal life.
To admit that every week during our brief time of silent confession in this holy place, I run out of time before I run out of my list of faults and failures. Those wrongs I had determined not to repeat, but had done again anyway. Our need to come to God and admit our sins is strong and abiding. Please join me in the prayer of confession found in the bulletin. Nurturing God, bread of life, we confess how we have failed to trust in you. We spend our days worrying about what we will eat, what we will drink. We enjoy our abundance without sharing it faithfully. We hoard our resources, fearing we'll run out. Forgive us when we fail to remember that you feed us with everlasting life. Help us to trust that your nourishing love will sustain us for all of our days. Amen. God hears our prayers. God loves us. God's mercy is bigger than any of our list of sins. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. In celebration of God's amazing grace and forgiveness, it is time to pass the peace of Christ to one another.
The peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. This is the time where we have children come forward, and we have a big crew this morning. All right, everybody. As the grown-ups are seated, I need all the children to sit down and keep their hands to themselves. I have three questions for you guys this morning. Number one, what is your favorite food?
Pizza.
Pizza. Anybody else? Chocolate ice cream. Noodles. What, Emery? Ice cream. Mimi, what's your favorite?
Spaghetti.
With. What's your favorite food?
Chicken nuggets.
How about you? Quiche. My goodness. We got a smorgasbord representative. What's another favorite, Carter? Chocolate cake and chocolate ice cream. Girl, I'm with you. Okay, here's a different question, and some of you may have answered it already, like Maddie, your question, and maybe. If there was a food you had to eat every day because it just fills you up and makes you feel good, it's like chocolate ice cream is special, but what is a food that you like that just fills you up every day? Noodles, I thought you might say that. Italian. Anybody else? Quiche, still your answer? I think milk might be Elliot's answer. He wants everyday pizza. Okay, now I have my last question. It's a little bit different. It's not about food. Okay. Yeah, maybe we should change tack here. My next question for you is, when you are having the worst day and you feel sad or you feel frustrated or you just feel like giving up, who do you go to talk to? Your parents?
My dog.
Your dog?
My sister.
Your sister?
And
a grown-up?
Sometimes
your teacher? Sometimes you scream in your pillow. Yeah. Are there words that when, if it's not your dog or your pillow, it's a grown-up or your sister or your parents, are there words that they tell you to help you feel better?
Mm-hmm.
Like, can you think of any of those words?
It's okay.
Anything else? Maybe I love you. Did they tell you that? You're my friend no matter what. Things like that. Yeah. Carter, what were you going to say? You're my best child. You and Mimi both are my best child. I bet that's what someone says to you. Well, I want to tell you something. In the Bible, Jesus says something that sounds a little strange. Jesus says, "I am the bread of life." That sounds a little strange, doesn't it? I am the bread of life. But here's what I like to think. You think you know what that's about? Say it, Maddie. Okay, that's all right. I think you kind of... There's connection with bread in the Bible, absolutely. You know, I think it's kind of like what Jesus means is a little bit of a combination of the answers you gave me to the questions. And that is, Elliot, you come sit with Dad. Just because people need to hear. Listen, what do you have? This? Yeah, you got it, Carter. This is my blood shed for you.
And the bread is my...
It's my body broken for you. Yeah. You guys, I don't need to preach later on. These kids are preaching for me. Jesus says, "I am the bread of life." And when we have the communion, we don't have it today, but when we have that meal, Jesus is saying, "I love you." And those are words that feed our hearts. Jesus says, "I'm the bread of life," because Jesus has words for us and he gave himself for us. He wanted to love us so much. That's right. That's right. That's absolutely right. And now you know what it means that Jesus says, "I am the bread of life." I'm so glad that you all are here to help tell this wonderful story that we have in the church. Thank you. All right, what we're going to do is we're going to thank Jesus for being the bread of life in prayer. Can we do that together? I'll say words and you repeat after me. Let's pray. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
For feeding us.
For feeding us.
With your love.
With your love.
And your life.
Help us
to be those who feed others with love and life. Amen. My friends, it is so important that you are here and that you are telling the story of Jesus' love. I'm so glad. And I think Miss Lady has more lesson and fun for you guys planned, so why don't you all take off, okay? We have been working through a sermon series coming to us from John's Gospel, in which Jesus speaks in metaphors. Jesus is telling us in this gospel through the stories and through his teachings who he is by using metaphors like, I am the good shepherd, I am the light of the world, I am the gate. And so today we hear from Jesus as he says, I am the bread of life, as you might have guessed. So I'm going to be reading to you from the sixth chapter of John, and a little background before we get to our text. We're very familiar, most of us, with the feeding of the 5,000. So in this story, Jesus has been out to teach, and more of a crowd than he expected has come. There's 5,000 people, they're very hungry, and Jesus performs the miracle of turning 5 loaves of bread into enough food to feed 5,000 people. And after that, John tells us he goes off to pray on his own, and it turns late. The disciples need to move on. They're going to Capernaum, so they get in the boat without Jesus because they can't find him. They start to sail. John tells us that Jesus walks on water to meet them, and then they get to the other side. And the next morning, I assume, this text isn't clear, the rest of the folks who had just been fed the day before, they see that Jesus is gone. And I think they decide that they need to hear more. They want to know more of what this Jesus is teaching. And so they join him across the sea. And so as I'm reading from John chapter 6, and I'm starting in the 25th verse. So it says, when they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, Rabbi, when did you come here? Jesus answered them, very truly I tell you, you are looking for me not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For it is on him that God the Father has set his seal. Then they said to him, what must we do to perform the works of God? Jesus answered them, this is the work of God, that you believe in him who he has sent. So they said to him, what sign are you going to give us then so that we may see it and believe you? What work are you performing? Our ancestors ate manna in the wilderness, as it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat. Then Jesus said to them, very truly I tell you, it was not Moses who gave you bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. They said to him, sir, give us this bread always. Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Gracious God, loving Jesus, Holy Spirit, we are so thankful that you speak to us by your living word. And we pray that as we have heard it and as it is proclaimed, and indeed as we take this word and let it live in us, that it would enrich our lives, nourish our souls, and nourish the world around us in your name. It is in your name that we pray. Amen. In the months and years following World War II, thousands of Jewish and non-Jewish children and adolescents who had been orphaned during the war found their way to orphanages that were located throughout Europe, if they were lucky. These were the survivors, the ones who had hidden out in the forest, the ones who had spent countless nights in abandoned barns. Some had been in concentration camps. Others had been captured and forced to labor. In one American-occupied part of Germany, a former monastery called Kloster Innsdorf became a temporary home for more than 1,000 child and adolescent refugees. Managed by the UN, they were helped to relocate their families or find new homes. A German Fulbright student spent nearly a decade researching as many of the children and adolescents, these orphans from Kloster Innsdorf. And one of the people that she found and researched and traced throughout his life spoke to her about his time as an adolescent in that home. One of the things he told her was that at night, the children would take the extra bread from the dining room to bed with them. They would sleep with loaves of bread. Traumatized by their experience of war and their own efforts to survive, they could only find rest if they knew there would be something to eat the next day. They were hungry for food, of course, but they also hungered for so much more than the satisfaction of their basic needs. Which is how the UN team that managed the home came to understand its purpose and mission beyond providing for the basic needs and finding homes for these children. They also understood that their job was, quote, to give each child a feeling of security, along with an understanding that he or she was desired and loved. Jesus tells his disciples, do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. What is the food that endures for eternal life? For the children of Kloster Innsdorf, it was a feeling of security found in the bread that they took to bed. But it was more than that earthly mix of flour and yeast and sugar and water. It was the promise that they wouldn't have to search again for food. It was the assurance that they didn't have to fear that bottomless pit of hunger, that dreadful truth that they could die of starvation at any moment. Later in the article that I was reading about this orphanage, someone described these children as having a rage for life. The food they needed was a relief from that feeling of rage required for survival. And it was also the understanding that despite all of their losses, their childhood, maybe their parents, their siblings, a home, that they were desired and loved. Children need that understanding. We all need that understanding, don't we? Which makes me wonder, what is the food that you need today? The food that endures for eternal life. Another way I could ask this is, what are you really hungry for? For what is your soul longing? What aspects of your life are undernourished these days? And what ultimately leaves you satisfied? I think our answers require some introspection. I think we have to dig a little bit deep, because there are plenty of voices out there or in here working very hard to tell us what we really need. And I'm not talking about the kind of voices that cry out in real hunger for bread like the orphans of war cried out for. I'm talking about the voices that convince us that in order to survive, we need to look or feel a certain way, to have a certain amount of wealth, to accomplish so much, to have a certain sized family, to believe beyond the shadow of a doubt a certain set of tenets, to have a particular set of experiences, to travel to particular places, to provide particular things for our families. It's amazing how much power we give these voices, how strongly we let them influence our lives. These voices can go so far as to dictate how we live, how we spend our money and our time, how we think, even who we love or don't. But at the end of the day, or at the end of our lives, it turns out that these voices rarely provide us with the sustenance we actually need, the food that endures for eternal life. So what is that food? Back in March, the Wall Street Journal published the somewhat alarming, but probably not that necessarily surprising, results of a poll. Maybe you read it. This was a poll about what's important in American life these days. Researchers found an overall decline in American involvement in communal life, in the desire or importance of having children, and in tolerance for others. They discovered that fewer Americans today put an emphasis on religion or patriotism, but more Americans today say that money and the acquisition of wealth takes top priority in their lives. Now, as with any poll, there are myriad ways to analyze and theorize about what these results actually mean. The responses that I have resonated with suggest that what this poll is really showing us is a decreasing ability or desire for people to see themselves as part of something bigger than themselves. We have been swimming in the waters of individualism for so long. And the institutions that require our time and our resources, like religion or civic organizations or even marriage and children, hold less significance than they ever did before. The pandemic, of course, didn't help. We had to separate from each other. We had to disconnect. And that, combined with sharp political divisions in our nation, have us pulling away from each other further and further. We are less invested in the good of our community and in the personal, ideological sacrifices and compromises that are necessary for communities to thrive. Now, I think polls like this are interesting, but they can be tricky, you know? They can be tricky because we can quickly move to finger pointing. We are all good at finger pointing, you know. We are quickly moved to find someone to blame. But the truth is that finger pointing and blame never really solves anything. And polls like this can begin to paint a picture that becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy. So maybe instead of worrying about all of this, what we can do is engage in a little self-assessment. Start with ourselves. Take stock of our values and our longings. Let's go back to those questions about our hunger for the bread of eternal life. What do you hunger for? Deep in your heart. Deep in your soul, and what can you consume to satisfy that hunger? Maybe you are hungry for better connections with your neighbors or even your family members. Maybe you hunger for a sense of belonging. Maybe you hunger for a break from the pressure to be perfect. Maybe you hunger for friendship or a romantic partner. Maybe you hunger for a rest from the busyness. Maybe you hunger for the assurance that you are making good life decisions, the right choices with your parenting or your grandparenting. And what you are doing with your money or your time, where you are in your life. Maybe you hunger for delight instead of so much frustration. Maybe you hunger for joy instead of so much anger. Maybe you hunger to find a real purpose for your life at whatever stage you are. Maybe you hunger for healing. Jesus says, I am the bread of life. Jesus is the one who satisfies our hunger, which is a lovely thing to say and something that I truly believe, but what does it really mean? I mean, what does it really mean when we are in the darkest nights or facing the biggest disappointments or when we are making the hardest decisions we have to make? How can Jesus help us like those loaves of bread helped the children in Germany? Here's what I think Jesus means and how he can begin to help. Jesus, the bread of life, feeds us with this promise. In life and in death, we belong to God. And even if we feel unloved or unwanted, we are always desired by God. And God will go to great lengths to seek us out, to chase after us, to stay with us no matter what. Jesus, the bread of life, feeds us with this truth. As long as we are living in love, we are living right. Maybe we can't afford the greatest trips. Maybe we can't always be present for the ones who need us. Maybe we can't figure out all the solutions to all the problems we face. But if we are living in love for God, for ourselves, for our neighbors, then we can trust that we are on the right path. Jesus, the bread of life, also feeds us with this hope that just as death was not his final act, it is not ours either. We can live in hope that God's love is more powerful than anything we fear could destroy us. And while there is pain in this life, while there is despair and loss and evil and violence and hatred, we can proclaim a greater power than any of those. We can proclaim God's love and grace and Jesus Christ, who comes and lives and dies and raises from the dead for us. And that's what saves us. And finally, y'all, Jesus, the bread of life, feeds us with the gift of the church. For here we have a community of welcome and belonging where all can come and hear all of these promises. God loves you. No matter who you are or what you have done, God loves you. You bear the image of God. You bear the image of God who made you for love. This is a special place of welcome and refuge where we do our best to love each other, not perfectly, but across any boundaries or borders that would separate us. And more than that, Jesus, the bread of life, gives us the gift of the church, which is the place where we find our greater purpose and meaning. For the church is the place where we are called to be a part of something bigger than ourselves. Jesus feeds us here and then sends us out to feed a world that is starving for what we are fed here. Love and hope and peace and kindness and goodness and joy. I don't know what you are hungry for, but I bet others are hungry for something like what you are hungry for. And the good news of the gospel, my friends, the good news that we bear into the world throughout our lives and with our lives and with our actions and our words and our deeds is that no one, no one, no one needs to go hungry. Jesus won't let us. I say this to you with such hope in the name of the one who is and who was and who is to come. Amen. I invite you to rise in spirit at this time. Now, as we together as Christ's body affirm our faith, you'll notice that it says the Apostles' Creed, but it's not the Apostles' Creed. We did that last week. We'll do it again another week. These are words that come from a brief statement of faith of our church. Church, what do you trust? We trust in Jesus Christ, fully human, fully God. Jesus proclaimed the reign of God, preaching good news to the poor and release to the captives, teaching by word and deed and blessing the children, healing the sick and binding up the brokenhearted, eating with outcasts, forgiving sinners, and calling all to repent and believe the gospel. Unjustly condemned for blasphemy and sedition, Jesus was crucified, suffering the depths of human pain and giving his life for the sins of the world. God raised this Jesus from the dead, vindicating his sinless life, breaking the power of sin and evil, and delivering us from life to life eternal. Amen. You may be seated. And as you are seated, I invite you to fill out the pads that you find in your pews, letting us know that you are here or expressing any interest you have in getting to know more about the life of our church. And I also just draw your attention to both our church calendar and the announcements that you find in your bulletin, letting you know about some things that are coming up for us throughout the course of this summer, ways that you might be able to be involved and be enriched. I'm grateful to Hilda Patrick for helping lead us in worship, and now she will lead us in prayer.
Please pray with me. God, our Creator, Sustainer, and Redeemer, you are the God who was present at the beginning of time. You are eternal and unchangeable. You are the God of the ancient covenant and the stable and the cross and the empty tomb. You are the God of the early church and the present church and this church. You created us in your image, and you love us with a love that never lets us go. We ask your blessing on those throughout our world who are hurting or afraid or discouraged. We offer prayers for those who are facing starvation for themselves and their children because of extreme poverty or war or political upheaval. We offer thanks for the lives and witness of those who work with organizations that battle hunger, often risking their own safety by going into areas beset by famine or natural disasters. Forgive us when we see images of your children with emaciated bodies and glazed eyes and fail to respond. We also pray for those with full pantries and refrigerators, whose stomachs are satisfied, but whose lives are empty because of mental illness or addiction or inability to resist harmful temptations. Be with our Associate Pastor Nominating Committee and with all of those on our prayer list and those who care for them. Today, Lord, we especially pray for mothers and grandmothers. Give us wisdom and courage and patience and abundant love so that we may be able to teach our children that it is even more important for them to belong to you than to belong to us. It is easy to find the right words when they are successful or celebrating. Give us words of hope and comfort when they have failed, when they are injured or ill, when they have hurt feelings, when they have lost a friend or a pet. Remind us to pray with them and for them, and to set an example of what it means to be a child of God and to rely on the strength of God's everlasting arms. Inspire us to share with them the stories of Jesus, your Son and our Savior, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Every Mother's Day, I remember my mother-in-law, Jerry, who, in addition to being just a bit of a character, was probably the most cheerful giver I have ever known. For many of her 96 years, she modeled generosity for her children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren. In her spirit of joy and gratitude, let us worship God with our tithes and offerings. accept these gifts from our hearts and hands and use them for the holy purposes of your kingdom. Bless those who give and those who receive. In the name of your Son, Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Not be the next meal you eat, but I bet you are going to eat a meal this week that you eat every week. You're going to have a bite of something that you're so used to having because it fills you up on a regular basis. And my challenge to you, my charge to you this week is when you take that bite, let it remind you of the truth that nourishes you, not just the food, but the bread of heaven that nourishes you. And as it nourishes you this week, my charge to you is to go out into the world and nourish the world as God would have you do. As you go, may the love of God, the grace of Jesus, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all now and forever. Amen.